family, sometime in the last, what, 20, 30 years ago, took that journal and massaged it and did a very nice job of editing it into making it into this book. And it just does a wonderful job of depicting what colonial life was like and how self-sufficient they were and how much they did on their property. And it's really, it gives you an insight into how flax was turned into linen. There's a number of the words that we use in our day-to-day vernacular came from the terms that were generated from farming and colonial life at the time. So it's a wonderful book to read. The other thing I'll contribute is that I live in the 228 Portsmouth Ave, which was one of the Wigan houses, and which I bought from Bob and Joan Ryan. before them, it was another chicken farm. It was the Whitaker's farm. And apparently in the 1950s, a chicken blight came through and killed off a bunch of the chickens. And the Whitakers said, now, this is a sign, it's time to get out of the chicken business. And so they started the Isles of Shoals Steamship Company line. But Mrs. Whitaker came over to the house one day and brought a bunch of the old family movies put on VCR videotape. And I'd be happy to give that to you, Becky, if I can find it.
Prior to the state straightening the road, it was a cement road. And it was the state of the art. It was the best road in the state, la, la, la. If any of you ever driven on a cement road, you know it's donk, 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 donk. And up until a few years ago, Emery Lane had the cement under the asphalt, and it was a donk, donk road. I think the town has removed most of the cement now. And another area where they straightened out the road is just beyond the Noyes property, if you're familiar with the Noyes property. If you look to the left there, you'll see the telephone poles going through the woods, and that's where the road was. They didn't move the poles over to the new road. They left them where they were, and they're still there.
Just a note on the cement road. The CCC built that during the Depression, and my own favorite part of that story is my father was a young child, lived down about a half a mile from the road. He had his first cow, so we put the milk in bottles and he wheeled the wheelbarrow down there and sold the milk to the guys working on the road.
So the Emery Farm was probably one of the first places that had a mission statement.
Yeah.
And I don't know if many people remember it, but it's we feed the living and bury the dead. That was the sign, right? And they did feed the living, and they did bury the dead.
And that's because he owned a cemetery. I just wanted to say that I've only lived in town for 70-odd years, but in the last 40 years, probably, we have lost probably a dozen houses on Portsmouth Avenue. So the fact that we have this many left is pretty amazing, but we also need to be aware of the fact that we've lost a lot from the circle toward Exeter. We've lost, in the last 40 or 50 years, there have been big changes on Portsmouth Avenue. And to think that it stayed the way it was for so long and then what we've done in the last 50 years, it's a little scary.
There's an Odell place across, originally a Bartlett place, across from Bunker Hill Avenue. Come this way to Butterfield Lane, and you'll see huge tension, high tension wires going across the road. Right under those wires, there was an old VZ farm right there. And I don't know when it disappeared, and I haven't seen any pictures, but I would love to get some.
People ask me, what's that deserted building between Market Basket and Shaw's?
Well,
now I'm on the spot. You can help me out with it. There was a house that went with that barn, and at one time it became owned by Uncle Nellie Labonte, who had owned the Stratham lumber store there, and also the Sunoco gas station, which was where the entrance to Shaw's is now. He built the Stratham Tire Empire, of which there's no more Stratham Tire in Stratham. But anyway, that barn was part of a farm. There was another house and barn up further up where the Subaru store is now. Doug and Stella, you can help me out on what else was down there. There were a bunch of other farms down that part.
The cattle crossed Portsmouth Avenue.
Maybe someone can catch that.
All right, Doug, you're on.
I don't remember exactly when the last day was, but my father was retired, and he watched the road, and he stopped, he opened the gate up when the first cow got there, and there was a line about 500 feet, and I asked him why he opened the gate so early. Because usually you try to get a group there to go across. He said, well, I wanted to see how long a line of cars I could make. And I told him you couldn't see the end of that line.
To 84 at least.
Because I remember one of the last times we put cows across, there was a guy that came up, and he didn't want to wait, so he started honking his horn. And I had to chase the cows all the way from River Road, and we got him to go back up my parents' driveway. And I was, if I could have done something to that car, I would have. Because that was difficult. And that's part of the reason why we had to stop moving cows across, is because the people were too impatient to let us cross the cows. And
do you still have the sign?
I think we do have the sign.
Just a sign.
We're putting them in the road, yeah.
When the state did their reconstruction in the 50s, they did it in a few different phases. One of the things that they allowed for is that we could cross cows across the road, because by increasing the size of the road, it made it more difficult to use. That farm was on both sides. Our family had two farms there. The first farm you bought in 46, January 1st?
Yes.
Which is from where the Nissan dealership is, and stretched down River Road, and then across the street on both sides of Frying Pan Lane. And then my parents and my grandfather bought the second farm, which stretches from the Nissan dealership to where my parents live now in 72. So there were two different farms that they combined. And that original farmhouse from the 46 farm burnt down when they were just the year they were putting in the road. So that was another farmhouse that disappeared, and barns. And somewhere there's a picture of them out milking cows with no barn. They just the concrete with the metal.
They put up a temporary roof on the old cement. But that was in 1955, because I remember the barn burned the last day of school, so I had a long summer.
One other quick one tying together the dairy cattle and the milkman and the use of Portsmouth Avenue. I remember Earl Barker mentioning that when he was a kid, high school was of course in Exeter, and of course there were no buses. So there were three ways of getting there. You either walked, or you took a horse, in which case you had to board the horse at the livery stable. So you had to go early enough in order to deal with the horse, or if you got lucky, you jumped on the back of the milk cart as the milk cart went by, and milkman was taking milk into Exeter to sell in Exeter. So his preferred method of getting to school was riding on the back of the milk cart.
My father used to ride a horse to Exeter, and he said at lunchtime he had to run downtown and feed the horse.